For Crema Media's Polity, I'm Sane Dlamini. Today on Politics 360, political analyst Ibrahim Fakir unpacks why we need electoral reform and what it might look like. Ibrahim, you say that something as basic as the electoral system should not be changed too often. Why do you say that?
Sane, the electoral system is something which is a basic component or a basic part of the establishment of our representative democratic government system. And it's the process by which we choose the people who make the decisions, right? And so if there's too many changes, too often, too frequently, it doesn't lead to stability. In fact, it leads to instability in the management of government, in the administration of government, and in such an instance, a void starts to exist. Citizens don't have any more trust or legitimacy and credibility in the processes of government. And so the instability starts to take root. Now, that's not to say that there mustn't be changes. Of course, there must be changes. But those changes must serve a purpose. And the purpose must be to enhance either the exercise and enjoyment of democratic rights, of entitlements that you have as a citizen, or to improve the performance of government, the administration and management of government, and lastly, to improve the experience of democratic government for ordinary citizens so that they have a responsive government, that the government is taking care of the kind of concerns and issues that face them directly and maintain peace, security, livelihoods, economic activity, and so on. So if you have too many changes too frequently, become unstable. On the other hand, when there is a necessity to change to enhance the democratic experience, the enjoyment of rights, and the performance of government, then of course there must be change.
So you speak of those three major principles when you talk about the newly designed system. What do you mean by democratic representation?
Well, I mean by that, Sane, that there must be effective representation of people, that the representation mustn't simply be of political parties or the interest of parties or the interest of a sectional or a particular section of society only. Now, of course, all parties represent certain specific interests, and that's appropriate. That's okay in a democracy. Sometimes those interests are narrowly defined. There's a space for that too. But by and large, the system must be oriented for effective representation, not just of parties and of their ideas and interests, but the interests of citizens. And so the important values there around democratic representation are about effective representation, firstly. Secondly, effective inclusivity, that the greatest number of people are included in the system and that the system accommodates all of the differing views, varied as they might be in society, and the different identities, importantly, right? So whether it be racial, whether it be others, they should all be accommodated in the system. So there must be inclusivity, there must be sufficient diversity, and there must be effective representation. And by and large, at the moment, our system has effectively served to represent the interests largely of political parties rather than of ordinary citizens. And therefore, the system ought to be changed to orient itself to serve the interests of citizens to a greater degree than they do those of political parties. And there isn't necessarily always a coincidence between the interest of groups of people in society and that represented by political parties.
And now, can you help by elaborating on the democratic governance and the ability to exercise effective?
So in the delicate system of representation, and when the institutions are configured after the election, right? If the system is oriented largely towards the interest of parties, in institutions, important things like oversight and accountability begin to be lost. Why? Because the interests of keeping those people who are in power continues apace. So those who are in parliament, who have the responsibility to oversee oversight over the executive, people who implement, are blunted for two reasons. A, they are colleagues from their own party. Secondly, they're likely to be more senior members. And thirdly, they're dependent on those people and that party hierarchy to be re-elected, not to be disciplined, to remain within the system, rather than to be excluded from the system. So it blunts the question of oversight. It blunts the question of the independence of mind that is required to ask the difficult questions. Then the flip side of oversight is accountability. And because accountability is lacking, because of poor oversight, there's no taking of responsibility. So you can see how this is starting to cascade in bad governance rather than good government. So you have poor oversight, you have lack of accountability. And when you put those two together, you have a lack of responsiveness. And the responsiveness is only to these circles of people who are included in the system. So by and large, the political parties, the political party elites, or certain sectional interests. And we've seen how in the nexus of breakdown between accountability, oversight and responsiveness starts to break down, and the responsiveness is only to a certain group of people who are inside, who are part of that elite, you have corrupt capture, you have the enablement of impunity and bad behavior, wastage of resources, not being responsive to the concerns and the issues which need to be solved in society.
You're also arguing in your column that while the interests and concerns of the political parties are valid, they should be secondary now to the interests and concerns of voters and or citizens. Why do you feel strongly about that?
I feel strongly about the fact that political parties are very important players, but they are subordinate players. They are merely instruments. They are merely vehicles which organize on behalf of certain ideas, on behalf of citizens, right? So, or bodies of opinion in society. And yet we found that the way in which parties have been behaving in institutions have been self-reflexive, have been self-interested, and have not even delivered to their own claimed constituencies of support, or their own bodies of opinion, which they believe are aligned to them. And so in those cases, in that case, I think it's better to start shifting the tilt of power away from parties to that of citizens. Now, of course, no electoral system is perfect. No design can minimize the fallouts. No design can force the fit between representativity, accountability, responsiveness, and so on, and which are always going to be responsive to a group of citizens or interest groups or that body of opinion, right? You will always have something slipping through the cracks, the arbitrage, so to speak. But we should try to design a system in which the tilt is in favor of serving the interests of citizens first. Secondly, there are many debates about the electoral system which says that, you know, if you design it in ways where there's too much latitude away from organized parties, that they can become unstable, they can lead to fragmentation in the system because parties start to fragment and they start to break up and then they proliferate. And because of that fragmentation, it leads to inability for coherence in government, to government performance, and therefore it leads to instability. Well, that may be true, but if you orient, and that's partly true, but doesn't always necessarily follow that it will be that way if the system is designed in a certain way. Clearly, there's a relationship between the design of the system and the political culture. The political culture, therefore, has to change, but the change won't happen if you don't give a greater amount of power and influence over the way in which the system works to ordinary citizens. So while fragmentation and factionalization and proliferation and instability and incoherence are important to consider, and we should maintain them and keep the elements of proportionality, which are important, because not only they're about stability, they're about inclusivity, they're about effective and broad representation. The thing is, we should retain that element. And in my proposal, I say that there should be an element of proportionality, but there must also be an element of direct accountability, responsiveness, and incentivizing oversight in institutions, because that will make government perform better. Now, in this tilt away towards citizens, one is then also suggesting that the responsibility when things don't work now does squarely begin to lie with citizens. Because at the moment, we can blame political parties. We can say, you know, it's the parties who haven't performed well. And in part, that's true, because parties haven't been responsible because our system has been overly oriented to cater for them and their interests. I'm suggesting we shift the responsibility onto citizens so that we take, as democracy suggests, greater amount of interest, but to exercise greater agency agency. And then if things continue to still fail, if there's still instability, there's still poor oversight, there's still poor accountability and responsiveness, we know that that's a failing of ours, because the responsibility was ours, the system is tilted in favor of us, and yet we didn't do so.
And lastly, why now do you say that the current system and the major thrust of any proportional system works to the benefits of most political parties?
Well, if you think of most political parties, from the third political party down, the EFF, they rely on the broad aggregation of support from different disparate places. Any move away from that proportionate system represents some kind of existential crisis for them. So they obviously will not be in favor of any system that moves away from proportionality. The second is that, you know, our constitution in section 46(1)(d) says that the system must result in proportionality. And our interpretations thus far have largely been that they must be in favor of proportionality for the parties. And that's, of course, that's vital. And there's a relationship between the proportion of support expressed by voters, which translates into support for parties. But there are other ways of testing proportionality on the side of citizens rather than just in the outcome for parties. And our total focus should be on that of the interest of proportionality expressed by citizens. And there are different mechanisms, different processes that can be used in electoral systems to test that proportionality. Some of it, even in single member constituency systems where you elect only one person in a direct election, where the person who has the most number of votes wins, you can test that proportionality by creating a threshold that someone must have above 50%, or they must have the greatest number of votes compared to all the other competitors with them in a single member district or a single constituency. When you aggregate that across the country, it will reflect the proportionate. It will not be strictly proportional, but it will be proportionately a representation of the greatest number, the expression of the greatest number of voters will for who they selected to be the representatives. So there are different ways of this, right? But the proportionality, the way in which it's interpreted at the moment in terms of our constitution, has been to the benefit of all of the major and especially the smaller political parties. Because without the proportionality element and without the current system as it is, many of them would in fact disappear. If you think about changing the proportional system on the basis of the last election in 2019, about seven of the political parties would likely disappear, because any system that moves away from proportionality would require concentrated pockets of support in geographically defined constituencies. And so therefore, most of the smaller parties depend entirely on proportionality. But we've got to ask the question, no matter how important the proportionality outcome and principle is, and it's vital, therefore I propose that it must be retained, we also equally have to ask how much with this, our fetishizing of the proportionality and the inclusivity of the smaller parties, how much that has served in terms of responsiveness, in terms of representation, in terms of oversight, exercising oversight and accountability. Of course, many of them motivated having for bad performance to go to court, for impunity to go to court, extracted levels of accountability in that way, but in much slower forms and way more delayed than it ought to have been. And it only happened because it was in those parties' interest to do so. Were it not, were they accommodated in the impunity, we wouldn't have found this. So we therefore have to provide a greater amount of independence of mind for our public representatives to perform public duties.
That was Ibrahim Fakir in conversation with Polity about why we need electoral reform and what it might look like.